China seeks to redesign its economy from export-driven, labor-intensive manufacturing to domestic-based consumption, services, and high-tech. The blueprint, known as Made in China 2025, is the first of three 10-year plans that seek to transform the country from the top down just in time for the 100th anniversary of the founding of the People's Republic of China. I'm your host Shirvan and welcome to Caspian Report. Before we continue, special thanks to today's sponsor Throne, Kingdom at War. If you enjoyed the lore of Game of Thrones and want to revisit classic games like Diablo or Final Fantasy, Throne is ideally suited for you. It's a free-to-play web browser game with millions of players. You don't need to download or install anything. Just go to the link in the description, build up your settlement, forge alliances, and claim what is rightfully yours. Now back to Beijing's plan to catch up with the West. China's low-cost manufacturing economic model has sustained years of rapid GDP growth. However, it has run its course. Underneath the surface, China has long struggled to foster indigenous innovation, a trait of authentic modernized economies like Japan, Germany, and the United States. Beijing has been able to get by due to its massive workforce and the import of foreign technology, but as wages continue to increase at home and competition from other low-wage economies emerge, the profits of China's labor-intensive sectors are not what they used to be. Without fundamental change, China will fall in the middle-income trap, where its economy stagnates while the benefits of low-cost manufacturing plummet. Hence, reform is the only way to maintain socio-economic stability. In practice, this means channeling funds into state-owned firms, state-controlled universities, and state-guided research and development centers. The Made in China 2025 initiative lists 10 industries that will help the state become a producer of high-value products and services. The first sector concerns information and technology. In the next decade, of all the up-and-coming technologies, 5G stands out most since it will open a whole new industry with applications such as the Internet of Things. 5G also happens to be the one area where China excels. Consider for a moment the dominant role of Huawei in global markets. Yet Chinese firms still rely heavily on Western intellectual property and components. To overcome these shortcomings, the 2025 initiative seeks to accelerate the development of semiconductors and expand China's market share in 5G. The second sector is industrial robotics. China cannot indefinitely continue to rely on low-cost labor. Electronics, auto vehicles, and other high-end products require high-end industrial robotics. Although China leads the world in terms of installing industrial robots, it only ranks 23rd worldwide in terms of robot density, with 68 industrial robots per 10,000 employees in the manufacturing industry. Compare that number to the United States, which sits at 189 units per 10,000 workers, or South Korea, which leads the chart with 631 units. Suffice to say, the most vibrant high-tech economies are also the most intensely automated nations. To catch up with the West, the 2025 blueprint seeks to increase China's robot density to 150 units, making it among the world's top 10. But robotics isn't just about physical hardware. It also requires sophisticated software, for which Chinese firms rely on foreign intellectual property. How Beijing intends to overcome this gap is unknown. The following four industries fall under the category of vehicle engineering. We will go over them one by one, starting with aerospace engineering. By 2036, the number of air passengers will nearly double, with China becoming the world's largest market. To compete with Boeing and Airbus, Beijing established the Commercial Aircraft Corporation of China, or COMAC for short. Since 2011, COMAC has tried but failed to mass produce the commercial airliner C919 because the company relies on foreign suppliers for components, software, avionics, engines, etc. The 2025 initiative doesn't expect a miracle but calls on COMAC to capture at least 10% of China's market share in air traffic. The aerospace industry is perhaps the pinnacle of the high-tech world. It requires near flawless performance. If Chinese companies can manage to compete in aerospace, then China can compete just about anywhere. The fourth sector is naval engineering. Shipping has become an indispensable part of China's economy, and it has granted Chinese firms unprecedented opportunities. It therefore makes sense to expand China's shipbuilding capacity. The 2025 initiative calls on China's shipbuilding industry to supply at least half of the world's demand for marine manufacturing equipment. Considering the current state of the industry, that is an unrealistic target. The 2025 initiative also highlights the need for deep sea exploration to encourage technological advances. As a growing power, China's future is ever more tied to the sea, and high-tech marine engineering would help the country to bolster its claim in the disputed South China Sea. The fifth sector in the 2025 initiative is rail transportation. Here, China outshines the competition with its network of high-speed railways. This year alone, the country plans to construct 6,800 kilometers of new railway lines. About half of this target will be high-speed rail. Outside China, the regional nations aren't doing so well. Asia needs more than $26 trillion in infrastructure investments through 2030 to maintain growth momentum. That comes down to $1.7 trillion per year. Rail transportation and equipment is one area where Beijing can make a difference to make up the infrastructure needs, which coincides with the land corridors of the Belt and Road. As such, the 2025 initiative calls on Chinese rail firms to improve their performance to undercut the competition. Sector 6 in the 2025 blueprint is automotive engineering. For over 6 consecutive years, China has been the top market for General Motors. Beijing now wants to move away from that trend as well as combat pollution by supporting the development of electric vehicles. The Made in China initiative requires electric vehicles to account for 40% of domestic car sales by 2025. It currently stands at 2.7%. Moreover, the initiative prescribes that half of the sales be Chinese vehicles. Some critics argue that this target is overly ambitious, but Beijing holds all the aces. The development of electric vehicles ultimately comes down to battery technology, which requires the proliferation of minerals such as cobalt. This is interesting because cobalt is concentrated in only a handful of states, such as the Democratic Republic of Congo, where China happens to have a mining monopoly. So, in the context of electric vehicles, cobalt, and Congo, Beijing is ahead of the competition. Altogether, development in the aerospace, naval, rail, automotive sectors all fall under the category of vehicle engineering. They make up the bulk of the 2025 initiative, with the other components focusing on power, agriculture, strategic materials, and biopharmaceuticals. Let's go over them one at a time. First up, power generation. In the last two decades, China's capacity for electricity generation has quadrupled. As energy consumption will continue to accelerate, Beijing will want to meet the demand as cleanly as possible. As such, the Made in China initiative calls for 80% of components in hydro, nuclear, and thermal power equipment to be sourced domestically by 2025. One area where Chinese firms stand to gain considerably is the stretch of energy projects along the Belt and Road. The next industry in the 2025 initiative concerns agricultural machinery. By 2050, some 255 million Chinese citizens are expected to move to the larger population centers, bringing China's urbanization rate at 70%, which is close to the urban scale in the United States. More people in the cities means less agricultural output, since it deprives the agricultural sector of its workers. So Beijing will have to feed its citizens while its rural workforce continues to diminish. To address this issue, the 2025 initiative calls for an expanded arsenal of high-tech agriculture machinery, of which 70% of the critical parts are to be constructed domestically. This would bring Chinese agriculture up to the standards of advanced economies. The ninth sector is all about new strategic materials such as superconductors, graphene, nanomaterials, biomaterials, etc. These materials are stronger and lighter, and they can be used in missiles, submarines, fighter jets, circuit boards, and so on. Beijing does not want to be dependent on foreign suppliers for any of them. As such, the 2025 initiative instructs the civil industries and the military to cooperate and claim a substantial stake in the global resource market. The final sector in the 2025 initiative is about biopharmaceuticals. China is headed towards a demographic crisis, and the leadership in Beijing knows it. In the past two decades, state health expenditure grew at a rate of 11.6% per year, while the economy grew at an average of 9.9% in the same duration. Without reform, China's aging population will create budgetary problems in the long run. The 2025 initiative prioritizes the development of the country's domestic pharmaceutical sector so that biotech makes up at least 4% of China's total GDP by 2020. By and large, some of the targets of the Made in China 2025 are outright unrealistic. However, it should be noted that this is only the first of three 10-year plans, with the collective goal being to transition the Chinese economy from export-driven labor-intensive manufacturing to domestic-based consumption, services, and high-tech. To accomplish this, Beijing must encourage Chinese intellectual property. Only by substituting Chinese tech for foreign tech at home can Chinese firms look to dominate overseas. In the areas of telecommunications, power generation, electric vehicles, and strategic materials, China is already witnessing success. However, the initiative has plenty of drawbacks. In the short term, to make up ground and bolster its native industries, Beijing will inevitably engage in commercial espionage, cyber theft, and forced technology transfers. Needless to say, European and American policymakers are suspicious of Beijing's activities and are increasingly looking to block Chinese access to core technologies, especially dual-use technologies which have civilian and military properties. For instance, as part of the ongoing trade war, the 10 industries which we went over are heavily targeted by US tariffs. From the Chinese perspective, however, foreign pressure only underscores the need to foster indigenous innovation. Plus, Beijing may not have much choice in the matter. The country is in a high-stakes marathon where it must outrun the approaching crisis. Beyond economics and science, there is an unspoken fear among Western policymakers that a modernized and wealthy China would translate into newfound geopolitical power. Beijing would be able to pull regional nations firmly into its orbit, and rarely, if ever, have established powers ceded their dominance to upstarts without a fight. This is about much more than just economics. I've been your host Shirvan. Special thanks to our Patreon contributors for making content like this possible. If you want to learn more about our crowdfunding, see the link in the description. For now, Sarou.